Next up, Azir. Take the floor, Azir.
Hey, good day, everyone. Let me share my screen so we can begin the presentation. Okay. My name is Azir Moneva, and I'm a postdoc at the NSER and the Haxe Hochschule. And today I'm going to present the results of our latest research in the field of situational cybercrime prevention. And in this project, what we attempt to do is alert the consciences of those potential cyber offenders, cyber DDoSers in this case, from targeting the gaming industry. We did so, and we did this project together with the Dutch police. And we did this project because given the growing interest in gaming and the popularity of esports, the gaming industry has been receiving a lot of cyber attacks, especially cyber dependent attacks in the form of DDoS attacks. Now, distributed denial of service or DDoS attacks are a type of cybercrime that makes a system unavailable to its legitimate users by flooding it with large volumes of traffic. And Marlene mentioned in her presentation that there's a large percentage of youngsters who self-reported having committed a crime. So in this presentation, we focus on those juveniles that are interested in carrying out these types of attacks targeting the gaming industry. So let me give you a little walk through the presentation. First, I will define what I mean by the gaming industry, because sometimes there's some confusion with the gambling industry. Then we'll present our preventive framework, which is based on situational crime prevention, and I will introduce our research design and comment on the results we got. And then we can have a little room for discussion, take some questions and whatever. So first of all, the gaming industry, what's this? Well, I'll tell you what's not this. So the gaming industry is not the gambling industry. And the main differences between these two industries, although both receive a large number of DDoS attacks, is that the gaming industry is generally based on virtual currencies and games of skill, such as League of Legends, Counter-Strike, FIFA, while the gambling industry is more based on real money, games of chance, and in games such as slots, roulette, poker. So from now on, let's forget about the gambling industry and let's focus on the gaming one. About the preventive framework we chose for this project, I will tell you that situational cybercrime prevention has been popular in reducing all sorts of traditional forms of crime in different contexts, and it's aimed at tackling immediate causes of crime as opposed to tackling or addressing the root causes of crime. And originally it was devised as a set of 25 techniques and divided in 5 categories, but cybercrime scholars have mostly focused on the use of warning banners as a means of implementing a situational crime prevention strategy in cyberspace. And these banners are usually intended to increase the perceived risk of potential offenders or to remove any excuses for non-compliance they might have. Fortunately for us, there's a growing number of studies which have developed some nice valid designs, and we can extract some nice information from them to try to understand what works and what doesn't in situational cybercrime prevention. So for example, we know that when hackers see one of these ads, they spend one of these warning banners, such as the one you're seeing on the screen now, they tend to spend less time into the systems they've just trespassed. And these banners also serve to halve the visits on to pornography, banned illegal pornography sites in a recently published study. So the results are really interesting. And the National Crime Agency in the UK also learned about these studies and implemented in 2018-2019 a Google AdWords campaign, which basically builds on this rationale of the use of warning banners, but in this case, a Google ad, which would resemble a warning banner, to try to divert potential youngsters to carry out DDoS attacks in general. And they use this warning banner, or in this case, this Google ad that read DDoS attack are illegal in the UK under the criminal code. And this ad was targeted general youngsters, young population. And the rationale for all this could be very well based on the recent research on the pathways into cybercrime, which, for example, Dr. Lundfeld is carrying out at present. And in his extensive research in this area, Professor Lundfeld has interviewed a lot of hackers. And one of the consistent conclusions he draws from these interviews is that when these guys wanted to learn more about cybercrime, more about how to carry out a cyber attack or a DDoS attack, what they would do, just like any one of us would do, is search for it in a search engine such as Google, or look for a video tutorial in YouTube, right? So following this knowledge, this means that Google could be an interesting platform to reach this population in the early stages of the criminal careers. And while the NCA was implementing this campaign at the same time, the Cambridge Cybercrime Center, the computer lab they presented in the previous session, were also doing some research into the evaluation of interventions of police in different cybercrime contexts. One of these contexts was DDoS attacks. And they actually, thanks to some nice infrastructure, they got of around 100 sensors around the world, which enabled them to collect data about DDoS attacks. And that produces a very accurate estimate of the number of actual DDoS attacks that are occurring. They were measuring the DDoS attacks that were occurring in the UK, of course. It is their own country. And they compared it to other countries in which they also had sensors to record this DDoS attack. And what they found is that the increasing DDoS attack trend flattened in the UK when this AdWords campaign was running. And this is very interesting now. Because, okay, now we see that the gaming industry has a DDoS problem, because it has a cybercrime problem. We know that situational cybercrime prevention might work in some contexts and in some cases, and when it's used through warning banners and through the use of Google Ads, it might also work in the case of DDoS attacks. So why don't do the same thing here in the Netherlands? This is what the police thought, and they contacted us to carry out a research to actually evaluate this. And this is what we came up with. In this research design, we attempted to devise a strategy to understand what is the best strategy to communicate with these potential DDoSers before they carry out that attack, so that they might read this interesting message, or they land on a nice landing page that actually informs them that DDoS attacks are illegal, they are harmful, they might have consequences, and that they might have want to put their skills into a good use for society rather than against it, right? So we came up with this quasi-experimental design, in which we would expect young Google users who are interested in carrying out DDoS attack to introduce one of these long set of keywords we came up with. And once they did so, they would see one of these four rotating ads, which could contain different messages: a blaming message, a deterring message, a teasing message, or an advising message. And depending on the group of rotating ads they were displayed, they would land on one of these two landing pages. So one formal landing page, which was designed with the police and had the police logo on it. It was written as if it was written by the police themselves. And in comparison, we had this other landing page, which was more informal in design. This was designed by ESL Play, which is a large gaming company. And of course, the design was different. It had the ESL Play logo, the tone was more informal, and we would like to, with this design, to see what actually is the best combination of the best ad with the best landing page in which that generate the most engagement between these users, because we assume that if they generate a lot of engagement among these users, they will be more effective in communicating the message that DDoS, carrying out DDoS attacks, is something that's wrong and they should be doing something else. So our campaign ran for 14 weeks this year, from the 23rd of January, so 2021, and until very recently, the 30th of April. And as you can see in this graph, it generated quite some nice interaction as measured by a number of impressions, in this case divided by 10, the blue line, and the number of clicks. This showed interaction during more or less, let's say, consistent, except for one huge spike that we observed on the 22nd of March. And we were really puzzled about learning that we had this spike in our data because we didn't know where it was coming from. But when we were talking with the police about it, one of the guys that was in charge of, you know, addressing DDoS attacks told us that, yeah, he was having a very busy week and that they had recently recorded a large DDoS attack. And when he told us the date, it perfectly overlapped with our spike. And this is very interesting because it means that it could mean that our impressions could be a proxy measure for an actual number of attacks. Of course, we really need to interpret this with caution, but this is really promising. Now, the ads we were using for this campaign were these four. So we had a control ad that would mirror the ad used by the NCA in the campaign that reads basically the same. So carrying out a DDoS attack is illegal in the Netherlands and the criminal code. And then we have three experimental conditions. We had the blaming ad that reads DDoS ruin the game for everyone. We got the teasing ad that asks users, do you want to DDoS a game? And then we have an advising ad that suggests users to play fair because it is losers who carry out DDoS attacks. And what we found in terms of engagement they generated is that the best performing ad was the blaming one. And it was significantly better than the control one and the teasing one, which more or less on par. And all those three were much better than the advising one. So now we know what's the best ads that we have to use in order to engage with this. Now, the audience that engaged with the ads, according to Google data, so again, it's a bit with caution, were majority males under 34 and especially under 24 years old. And the keywords they were searching for were these ones, as you can see in these two axes, so that lets you see actually the engagement ratio this keyword generated compared to the mean cost per click. So this allows us to identify what are the keywords, not only the keywords they search for, but what are the most cost efficient to continue with our campaign in ours in a sustainable way. And we also observed time patterns. And these time patterns showed, for example, that the searches were carried out more often or peaked on Mondays at 3 p.m. in the afternoon. But of course, searching for DDoS related terms does not really necessarily mean that these people is interested in carrying out a DDoS attack. So this is probably a reflection of the routine activities of general users. In contrast, the engagement that these ads generated, so this is the impressions to clicks ratio, peaked on Sundays at 1 a.m. and this is Saturday late night. And this is now a weird time slot if you're just interested in knowing more about DDoS, right? And it's not people that just search for the keywords, it's people that actually clicked on the ads. So this shows that they had a specific interest in them. So could this difference be attributed that this reflects the routine activity of potential cyber offenders? Well, still no. We still don't know, but we are trying to make sense of it. And when it came to the landing pages, and we compared to the signs, we had different events in place. So we would be able to measure number of visits, percentage of page of the landing page scroll down, interactions with videos, so times the video was started, stopped, completed, and so on. We also were able to measure number of clicks on the URLs and so on. We basically saw the same difference as you can see in this image, which is none, right? So no differences between the informal landing page designed by ESL and the formal landing page designed by the police. And what all this means is that now we have a valid communication strategy. Now we know how to engage with these people. What's the best way to do so? So in a second step of this project, we want to get our hands on actual DDoS data, carry out a second campaign on Google Ads, and see whether they have an effect on the Google, on the DDoS attack trend, just like the Cambridge Group showed with the NCA's AdWord campaign. So thank you very much for your attention. Now, if you have some questions, we'll be happy to take them. And you can always contact me at this email address or through my Twitter handle that you can see on the screen. Thank you very much.